Have your word.
The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass.
So here we have the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants, his church, his disciples, his followers, things which must shortly come to pass. So here the book of Revelation is a book written to the church regarding things that the church would face throughout the gospel day. God gave it to Jesus. He revealed it to his servants, and he put it in symbolic form, symbolic language, so that the church would see it, hear it, understand it as God revealed it. But those that were not a part of the church or were not truly saved, not led by the Spirit of God, wouldn't understand it. Now, there's a lot of confusion about the book, but those that do have the Spirit of God are not confused at all.
Amen.
All right, so Revelation, God giving a divine revelation, is an important and critical part of the way that God communicates with mankind. We want to continue looking into the thought of the necessity of a divine revelation. You'll go through things in your life in which it's going to be critically important that you receive a revelation from God himself. You're going to make decisions in life in which it's going to be critically important that you receive a revelation from God himself. There are some things in life that are more weighty that God does not leave that to us to just happenstance, just get, or just possibly we may get it or we may not. One of them is salvation. The Bible said that this is the light that lighteth every man that comes into the world. So salvation is so important, because when a person don't receive salvation, then when we leave here, we won't be prepared when we stand before God. All right, the Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. I don't care how long you live, eventually you're going to die if you're not here when God comes back. And after death, that's not the end of mankind. But after death, we'll go and stand before God. And when we stand before God, we'll have to give an account of what we did with this thing called salvation. What did we do with his son, Jesus Christ? And God knew that our eternal destination in eternity, there's two places, only two places. You won't go to both, you'll go to one or the other. There's a place called heaven where those that are obedient, those that receive God's Son, Jesus, into their heart, give their lives to God, and live according to God's word after they're saved, will go. But there's another place called hell where those that reject salvation, or those that disobey God, or say, God, I'm going to live how I want to live, I'm going to do me. Well, if you're going to choose to do you while you live here on earth, then you're going to do you in eternity.
Yes.
All right. So here is very important that a person, while they're here on earth, it's important that you go to kindergarten. It's important that you go to sixth grade. It's important that you go to middle school. It's important that you get a high school diploma. It's important that you develop some type of skill or credential that makes you marketable in the world today. That's important. But more important than all of that is what you do with God's Son called Jesus. More important than all of that is your decision to give your life to God. Can you imagine if the only way to get to heaven was if you attended Jackson College? Or the only way you went to heaven is if you attended Harvard University. That particular university is the only way you can get to heaven. Well, the only way, God said, the only way to me is through his son.
Yes.
So with God knowing that that is critically important, some people may choose to go to Jackson College, they may not. Some people may choose to go to Harvard, they may not. They may go to Columbia, or they may go to Stanford, they may go to Duke, they may go to Los Angeles Community College. That's on them. But that is not that weighty of a decision that God would reveal that particular thing, that college, to everybody in the world. But eternity being predicated on the decision that you made, and it's only one way Yes. That you can make it to eternity, prepared to stand before God and spend eternity in heaven. God said that is so important that I'm not going to leave it to mankind to make it clear to you what you need to do to be prepared for that day. Right. So in John the first chapter, he said, this is the light. He wasn't talking about a light that's up here in the sky. He was talking about an understanding. This is the light, Christ, that lighteth, that gives everyone an understanding. This is the light that lighteth every man that comes into the world. I used to think, what about a little child in Africa? What if they never ran into a Bible or ran into a preacher? God will make it critical. He will make it possible for every single person, some type of way, if he got to do it through a dream. If you get to do it through, maybe it's just a little track that they run up on. Maybe it's through one sermon that they ever heard. That's why I always said, a Church of God child, I don't think there'll be a hotter place in hell.
Come on, My God, that's right.
Think about this. God, some little child in somewhere, God reveals salvation to them one time. And they end up standing before God. Lost. But here, service after service. Service after service. And I'm not talking about uncertain way of what salvation is. You got children breaking down the heart chart last night. Did y'all see that? Children breaking down the condition of man. God created mankind pure. God created mankind in his image. God created man in his image pure. God is holy, wisdom pure. But because of sin, our forefathers disobeyed God, Adam and Eve. So what? They were born with a sinful nature. That's why you don't have to teach a child to commit sin to disobey God or do this, that, the other. Okay, so David said, in sin did my mother conceive me. You ain't got to teach a child to lie. They'll do it. Why? Because something in them will call it. You ain't got to teach a child to get an attitude. Don't give them that cookie. They'll throw a fit, fall on the ground, flip up. Where'd that come from? That came from Adam and Eve. Well, once they come to the age of accountability, they get old enough and they understand, I'm not just doing mommy wrong, I'm doing God wrong.
Yes.
God start dealing with their heart. Now that root, that seed down in them, begin to grow a tree. And these are all types of fruit of sin. Lying, jealousy, fornication, stealing, smoking weed. But thank God, God deals with their heart. He lighteth every man that come into the world. You need to be saved. Cut that out. I got a plan for your life. You don't need to do wrong. I got something better. This is the way. Walk ye in it, my God.
Come on.
Hold on. There's a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof. They sit at the altar because their fingers begin to get cold, clammy, and oh, that's God dealing with them. You can see when they're younger, they sit through an altar call. They really don't perceive what's going on. But once they start hitting that age of accountability, you'll find them kind of fidgety. My God, what God is dealing with them. So God deals with them and lightens them to their condition. They come to an altar of prayer, they get saved. That tree is cut down, thank the Lord. They're forgiven, my God. But still, there's a little seed there of self that won't take away. Although they're saved and they dealt with sin, they still got to deal with self. They got to just put self on the altar. You say, why didn't they put self on the altar here? Why? Because God can't accept the sacrifice unless it's holy and pure. So that sacrifice first had to deal with sin. When a person deals with sin, now the Bible said, beseeching therefore, brother, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. You're not acceptable right here. That's why you can't get sanctified here. That's why it's two works of grace and not one. That's why you gotta be holy before God will accept the sacrifice. You can't come to God with no big old tree and say, God, I give you my life. No, God, I'm asking you to forgive me. That's all you can do. You come to God and ask for forgiveness. That's all you are in a position to do. Now, once you get saved, once you get forgiven, once you are holy, now you can go and present your body a living sacrifice, and God removes that selfish carnal heart and restores you back to the pure position that mankind was created in.
The Lord.
So here, there's a plan of salvation. But God knew that we wouldn't make heaven unless we truly get saved. Now there's babbling all around us today. They'll teach you, you just start joining church. You don't deal with your tree. You gotta deal with your tree if you're gonna get saved. You gotta deal with the tree. Micah, you can't serve two masters, God. You can't bear fruit, my God, of fornication, lying and ungodliness, but also fruit fruit of peace, joy. No. If you're going to bear one fruit, a good tree cannot bring forth bad fruit.
Come on, come on.
A good tree, if you truly say it, you won't produce fruit that is bad.
That's good, brother. Amen.
But here, although God enlightens us to the plan of salvation, because over in Amos 8:11, don't go there, it said in the last days there shall be a famine.
Yeah.
Not a famine of food, grain, wheat, but a famine of the word of God.
Yes.
In the last days, what was he talking about? He said you can go turn your radio on, go to churches, and you will find very few people that truly understand the real meaning of salvation. John 3:3, don't go there. He said you must be born again. Understand that you don't join church. You get saved.
Come on, yes.
God got to reveal that to you. We're praying tonight that somebody on air, somebody that's tuned into the broadcast, will understand and God will give them a divine revelation. When you truly get saved, you're born again.
Yes.
He changes who you are. You don't get better. You become a new person in Christ. That takes a revelation from God. You know what? One person was saying this the other day. He said, I never heard this before. And he was older. Said, I never, nobody explained to me that you can't serve two masters. Nobody ever explained to me that when you get saved, you let go of all you know to be wrong. Nobody ever explained. I didn't know that. I just thought that you go up, you go to, then you start going to church. If you're living with your boyfriend, you keep doing that. You know, but now you just saved. So you just learn some scriptures and you say, yep, you go get baptized. Well, when you get baptized, the Bible said that we're to walk in the newness of life.
Yes.
That's what baptism represents. Come here. That's what baptism represents. Come here, I'll use you as an example. So here we got baptism. It represents a person going down in a watery grave, being resurrected, a new person in Christ Jesus. Jesus was such a teacher and such an example setter. He said, we're going to have something that clearly shows what actually takes place down in the heart.
My Lord.
See, that's why we don't baptize children. That's completely unscripture. The Bible says, him that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. A child don't got the capacity to believe. Don't understand the plan of salvation and believe the work of God, this, that, and the other. No. You must want to give them a false hope. There's some people that said, I ain't going to get saved later. Well, I was baptized as a child.
Yes.
What in the world does that mean? That don't mean anything. The Bible said, well, hold that standing at the door and knock. You got to open that heart door up. That child didn't let Jesus in. That child didn't know what y'all was doing. Right. Probably thought he was taking a bath. But here, the scripture says that you're walking in the newness of life.
Yes.
God got to reveal that. God got to remember, we've had some people come out of prison and they'll come, they'll think this is a program. They say, I'm a part of the Church of God program. Yeah, we go on Sunday with a service twice. Then in the morning time, we get these counseling sessions with the pastor. I said, but this ain't no program. This is where salvation.
Amen, brother.
This is salvation, my God.
Right.
Amen. Yeah, you can get delivered, my God, more than a program, a 12-step program can ever do, my God.
Yes.
This is salvation.
Yes, sir.
This is not something we do while we're at church. This is something that affects every aspect of our life.
Yes, sir.
You know how people wear that thing, what would Jesus do? That's a cliche for most people. But for them to actually fathom, that's what salvation really is. What would Jesus do? When we listen to something, we're not going to listen to nothing Jesus wouldn't listen to.
Amen.
When he listens to, yeah, let me sex you tonight. Oh, would Jesus listen to that?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, thug for life.
Oh,
I'm a
God. No.
Hold on. Would Jesus listen to that?
Right.
Salvation changes who you are. You don't desire that no more. And you walk in the newness of life. That's how you have a testimony. The Bible said, ye are the light of the world. People don't understand this. So we're praying that God will grant them a revelation. When you come get saved, you are God's example for a human on earth, how God desires for a human to live.
Amen.
That's what salvation is.
Yes, sir.
You are God. You're saying that I will be God's example on earth. That's why I say you are the salt of the earth. You make a difference everywhere you go. Why? Because you're living like God would have for you to live. So a revelation is God revealing himself, revealing a particular understanding, and he'll usually do it when there's something weighty involved. We want to look at a few examples regarding the necessity of a divine revelation. Acts 20, 28, and 29. The Apostle Paul. Let's look at the Apostle Paul, and then we're going to give the steps of a divine revelation. The Apostle Paul, he had received divine revelation. Acts 20, 28, the Apostle Paul received a divine revelation regarding his departure and what would take place. Come on, read.
Take heed therefore unto yourself.
So he's talking to the church. He says, take heed therefore unto yourself. Come on.
And to all the flock.
And to all the flock, the ministry, come on.
Over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseer.
Uh-huh.
To feed the church of God.
Uh-huh. The name of the church is in the Bible. We don't name a church based upon what we like or scripture we like or some man. I appreciate John Wesley, but we don't name the church after John Wesley. Amen. I appreciate Martin Luther.
Amen.
But we don't name the church after Martin Luther.
Thank the Lord.
I appreciate baptism is important. But we're not going to name the church baptism or anything else. The Bible is clear. He said to feed the church of God. God already named his church. You read any of the letters, go back to the beginning of Corinthians. He said unto the church of God at Corinth. God already named his church. Alright? So why? Because the church identifies who it is. It's God's church. It's not man's church. It's God's church. So here he told them to feed the church of God, which he had purchased with his own blood. Now verse 29.
For I know this.
I know this.
That after my departing. Shall grievous wolves enter in.
How did he know that? Revelation. Here he was about to leave, and God showed him. After I leave, some folk will come up in here and try to tear this thing up. He said, I'm telling y'all right now. After I leave, some people gonna come in here, and some gonna rise up among y'all. Some gonna rise up among y'all with some strange stuff. Trying to get people after them. He said, but how did he do that? God gave him a divine revelation. In one place, at the end of his life, here was Apostle Paul praying for the dead, praying for people to get out of jail, all this other stuff. At the end of his life, and he wasn't real old. He said, for I fought a good fight. I kept it. The time of my departure is at hand. Why? God revealed to him. Sometimes, even in life, we're dealing with people as they get older. And sometimes God revealed it. So God showed me. It's my time to go. Now, sometimes people say that falsely. People come, one brother was saying it's time to go. It was in a real stuffy room. And he was dealing with affliction. And the pastor went over there. And the pastor said, how you coming, brother? He said, God showed me it's my time to go. And the pastor said, oh, he did? Opened the window, the fresh air came in. Brother said, where are my tracks at? I'm going out to have some tracks, my brother. Sometimes the enemy can get in and say, that's why a lot of times we'll get there in the moment. When you have revelation, you want to seek counsel about it. So here the Apostle Paul had received two different revelations. He also received a revelation of truth on Damascus Road. So there will be times in which we'll be making decisions. And we're going to get into this pretty deep tonight in the minutes that we have remaining. Some decisions that we make are principle-based. Like the Bible said, if a man doesn't take care of his own, he's worse than an infidel. So I don't need a divine revelation. Tell me I need a job. It's some things that are principle-based. All right? There's some things that are principle-based. Okay? So we don't need a divine revelation. There's some scriptures. You won't fall. See, God don't waste his breath. Don't waste his pen. Stuff that he's already dealt with. I need a divine revelation. No. Some stuff are based upon principle. But some decisions, we will seek God for special revelation. These decisions could involve a certain job offer. And this job offer may require like a certain commute, or may require you giving up something that you got that's substantial, or it may affect your family. I've seen individuals accept some things that wasn't according to God's plan for them. Completely spiritually diminished. Not one brother said this one time. He said, God ain't looking for ability. He's looking for availability. Everybody's so busy. He said, everybody's soul, life is soul, and that's what the devil wants to do with all of our lives. Get his soul constrained that we only got a little bit of time here for God. A little bit. Can you imagine if your schedule was as free as possible? In which you had opportunities that God could use you, that God could this thing, this time, this, that, and the other. So sometimes, some decisions that we'll make regarding employment and different things, it will affect our lives, affect our availability. Those type of situations, you see God and say, Lord, reveal to me.
Man.
Am I supposed to, you don't just jump, oh, this is more, $6 more an hour. Listen, I'd rather be in God's perfect will, make $6 less an hour, be available for what God needs for me, than to make $6 more an hour and be out of God's will. Many times individuals will make decisions without God revealing to them that decision regarding employment. Also, leadership positions in the church. Many times there's a certain level of responsibility attached. And you need to God to reveal, is this what I'm supposed to be? The Bible speaks over in Corinthians, I don't want to go there, that the Lord sets an order in the church. You want to make sure, saying, Lord, just because an opportunity opens, the door opens, I'm not just jumping in. Why? There's a certain consecration necessary to carry it out. There's a certain responsibility that comes to that. And let me hit the last one. There's a certain accountability you're going to give by assuming a certain responsibility. That's why the scripture said in one place, make full proof of your ministry. Since you want to go there and you want to involve here, since you want to be the one that's got these children at this point in their life and this, that, and the other, and you better make sure God is calling you to this. You better make sure you got a burden for this. Why? Because what God calls, He'll equip. This most critical age of their whole life, when their minds are being framed concerning the things of God, and you just doing something because you don't want to sit in church. You just doing something because you want to sit. But Lord, make it clear to me where I'm supposed to be and what I'm supposed to be doing. You talking about a church hitting on all cylinders? Why? Because individuals got before God, got prepared, got a revelation from God, made it clear. And don't get afraid of the word. Revelation. It's simply God revealing to you clearly what His will is pertaining to a certain situation. It could be who to marry. You, listen, these things are too weighty.
That's right, brother.
You just don't just, oh, I like him. What does God say? The pastor? He pulls you in the room. Pulls you in the room and he's saying, listen, what is God saying here? Have you prayed about it? I'm going to tell you this. Don't think you're going to pray clearly after you get your heart all involved in something because you've been communicating with somebody before you got a revelation.
Oh, man.
Amen.
Don't think you're going to see clearly or hear clearly when you've already got your emotions and your feelings attached and involved with somebody. There's nothing wrong with talking to people. There's nothing wrong. We're all family. We're all friends. This, that, and the other. There's nothing wrong. But the moment you can sense it's going beyond that, and you're continuing it without getting a revelation from God, you are out of order.
Amen.
You are out of order. Don't say, well, brother, he said we shouldn't talk, connect, and y'all going over this and the other. But the moment it gets personal, somebody you texting every day, somebody you calling all the time, hey, what you doing? Y'all just like that, huh? And you can sense it's something different. It ain't just the Bible said, treat your brothers and sisters as brothers, as sisters. The moment you can sense, this is beyond just a brother in Christ. I'm feeling something here. I'm away and I'm bringing you something back. Hold on. Hold on. Here you are involving yourself to that degree. You've not got before God, got a clear understanding from God. Hold on. I'm sorry. Let's deal with this. All right? Go over to 1 Corinthians 14:40, and then let's look at the process of finding the mate. I'm sorry. Let's go here. The Holy Ghost just said, go here. First Corinthians, He revealed to me, we need to go for some reason. 1 Corinthians 14:40, there's one verse there. Then let's go over to Genesis 2:7 to look at the revelation process of finding a mate. Come on, read.
Let all things, everything,
come on.
Let all things
be done decently. That's why we don't flip around in the church, fall down on a carpet, dresses flying up in the air. That's not decently. Let all things be done decently.
And in order.
The way God operates is decently and in order. There's an order to things. God will never provide a revelation that will knock things out of order. God's revelation will never contradict His word.
Amen.
Oh, we said something there.
Oh.
God's revelation will never contradict his word. Oh, God revealed to me, I'm going to be at home, and I'm going to say, the Bible said, forsaking not the assemblies of yourselves, because you ain't got no business at home. You know what, man? We living in a day and age where people want to do what they want to do. You'd be shocked how many people spiritually just doing what they want to do. And they want to be somewhere that they can do what they want to do. And wherever they can be and do what they want to do, that's where they want to be. They don't want nobody to have nothing to say what I got. I want to do what I want to do. And it's amazing how many people got strange philosophies. Hold on. I'm sorry. We're going to come. Okay. Now we're going to transition to the position or the order of finding the mate. But before we do that, go to Jude 1:5. People, I'm sorry, the Holy Ghost is preaching tonight. Folks doing what they want to do and still claiming to be saved, still claiming to be Church of God, still claiming, and they're going against their own revelation. Read. Jude 1:5. Read.
I will therefore.
I'm going to show you the danger of messing with a revelation from God. Read.
Put you in remembrance. Though you once knew it.
Hold on. Though you once knew this, you've seen it, you knew it clearly. It said once. What is he saying? You don't know it no more.
My God.
Hold on. Read that again for me one more time. People messing with divine revelations. What? God has shown them clearly his word, his doctrine, his standards, his truth, his church, his process. But they got full of themselves, wanting to do what they wanted to do, mess with a divine revelation and say, well, I don't see that no more. Don't you know how scary that is for you to say something like that?
My Lord.
That's selfish.
Don't you realize how severely serious that is for you just to say something that just casual? Well, I don't see it that way no more. God revealed to you, you testified, you proclaimed it, and signs and wonders backed it up. The Holy Ghost gave you an assurance and a peace down in your soul.
Come on, brother.
And now you got the audacity to say,
deception.
I don't see it no more. You will mess with a divine revelation? God showed you his church. God showed you his truth. God showed you his doctrine. God showed you his standards. And now you're going to say, well, I don't, and almost with a pride about it. And I don't see it no more like that. He said, though you once knew this. In other words, you don't know it no more. Why? Because you toyed with a divine revelation. Now you're spiritually confused. Don't you toy with no revelation. Revelation is a privilege. All this confusion in the world today, you get a revelation, you hold on to it.
Yes.
You write that foolishness down. Paul said a revelation was so powerful, he said, if I change or an angel from heaven come and try to change your mind, don't you change.
Amen.
My God.
Now you got people changing left and right. Every day almost, somebody else come with some strange philosophy. The Bible said, though you once knew this, in other words, you don't know it no more. You toyed with a divine revelation. Now you're confused and you're in darkness. And the Bible said, if that light indeed become darkness, how great is that darkness? Don't even try to do it. I'm just going to pray for you. I'm not even going to try to deal with you. Candlestick been removed. You have no clue. Don't you play. If you ever understand what salvation is, don't toy with it. Don't play with it.
Yes.
If you ever understand clear doctrine, clear standards, don't you let nobody come in here. Don't you go nowhere. Somebody confuse you. I'm going to tell you, a little leaven leaveth the whole lump.
Amen.
Some things you give audience to, it affect you. You don't see it that way no more. Pastors often said, he said, man, keep your eye on it. If God show you something, keep your eye on it. Because you look away and you look back, it ain't going to look the same.
Yes.
It ain't going to look the same. So don't toy with a divine revelation. I don't care if your mama changed.
Yes.
I love you, mama. But I'm not going along with no foolishness. I love you, daddy. But I'm not going along with no foolishness. And I'm going to show you how deep it is to toy with a divine revelation. Don't you realize some of the deeper things of truth that people are playing with today? That God would have been messing with their minds because he didn't just show them that. He showed them a whole variety of truths surrounding that. So if that was wrong, then what was all of this? What were all these things here? Was that wrong too? Well, then how do you know what you're doing now is right?
My God.
Toying with a divine revelation.
My Lord.
All right. Let's go to Genesis chapter 2. Let's deal with marriage. I'm sorry. Genesis chapter 2, verse number 7.
And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground.
And the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground.
and breathe into his nostrils the breath of life.
All right, so the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. I'm going to read.
And man became a living soul.
Read.
And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there he put the man whom he had formed.
Mm-hmm.
And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight,
mm-hmm.
and good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
All right, so the Lord God formed man. So first of all, we see that he's a man. I don't think you got that.
Amen.
So, God is not going to leave.
Amen, brother.
Watch this process. No boy. And two, man denotes maturity. Maturity enough to handle the responsibility. So first of all, when somebody comes up to the ministry and they're talking about, well, God, let me this, that, and the other, but they spend all their money before they even make it on bubble gum, Nintendo, Sega Genesis, or whatever video games they got today, Xbox, PlayStation. God's got, there's a maturity, you're giggly and laughy. Every time somebody sees you, there's no maturity about your thought process. It's just a lightness about you. Your decision making. God is a God of order. He's not going to lead you somewhere in which you're not equipped to deal with the responsibility. Don't you realize what it's like to be at home and somebody send you a text picture of your fence completely blown down? Your roof with a big hole in it. You cannot panic. You have to be in position to deal with it. And let me just take this to the next level to be equal with this. A woman, not a little girl. You sitting there and you got responsibilities in the home. Then you got your husband needs this. Now you're not feeling good in the morning time. If you ain't got a certain maturity, it'll overwhelm you. It'll mess with your mind. Then you find out that something else is going on, and it's a bit much.
Yes.
And you still like to run around with your little friends every other day. You get married, and he lets you realize you're not going to be going out every other day with your friends. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. And I flip back around. You with your boys every other night and this, that, and the other. She pull your coattail. My God. Amen. Hey, Lord, where you going? Where you going? Amen. Thank the Lord. You used to buying this and buying that, buying the other. Now all your money with your gator belts and your this, that, and the other, diapers and amen, and little ringling to play with, a little teeters and all this. A man, you ain't a man. You can
be. I just had to go with you. I wanted my haircut every other day, but
praise the Lord. I appreciate your haircut every other day. Now you gotta get a new style. You don't need it every other day.
Right.
Why? Because we gotta take care of, amen, responsibility.
Amen.
So here we see first it was a man. All right, skip down to verse 15. The process of getting married part of the divine revelation. Come on.
And the Lord God took the man
and
put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it.
This brother had a place and a job. Are y'all seeing this divine revelation? So one, he was mature enough,
praise God,
to handle the responsibility. So if anybody come and they talk about, well, God led us to so and so, that God ain't need that divine revelation. No, because God is a God of order. First, you're gonna be mature enough Second of all, he had a place to take her, and he had a job. The Bible said that a man has to leave father and mother and cling. Don't come talking about God led me here if you don't have the wherewithal to take care of her.
Yes.
All right? Keep going. Next one.
And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, Of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die.
And man, three, man shall have an established spiritual experience. You say, brother, that was just one verse. That was the entirety of the whole law of God. God revealed to him the entirety of the whole law of God. He understood the relationship of God, what it required, the understanding of the truth of God, what it was. So what you have an estab- don't let somebody get saved on Monday and God then revealed your husband on Tuesday. That they ain't in no way. Or you get saved on Monday and on Tuesday sister so-and-so look real good. That ain't the way God works. Before God, I'm gonna get to Eve. She ain't even showed up yet. She ain't even showed up yet. First, he was a man. Second of all, he had a place to take her and a job. In other words, he had the wherewithal to handle the responsibility of meeting her needs. Next, he's at a solid experience and relationship with God. You are about to become the priest of your home. I was telling my brother yesterday, I said the reason why you don't have a lot of church of God homes, because you got men that try to go into the position without having the spiritual understanding and wherewithal to disciple and shepherd that home. You are basically a pastor. You are basically the overseer of that home. You will give an account, not her. On the day of judgment, you will give an account of your home. Good. You will give an account of what went on, what didn't go on, and here you are. You can't even have a devotion. And you won't have one with your children, praying for your family, and you go 3 and 4 days without praying. You go 3 and 4 days without getting into your word. Come time to get into the word, you ain't sitting there eating the word up, taking notes, got your Bible study going up. How in the world are you going to train and teach your children in the way? What? And I would ask him, and the pastor does. He goes through this list that I'm going over. Maturity. Can you provide for? Then he looks her dead in the eye. Now I'm going to tell you, don't come into this already blinded. Do you feel that he has the capacity to pray the prayer of faith if you are going through something right now? In other words, do you have confidence in the depth of his spiritual experience that he can lead this home? See, there's a certain spiritual authority you gotta have. You ain't gotta argue with your children. You better not. Just have a certain spiritual authority. Even regarding your wife, husband, this and the other. Have a certain spiritual authority. Your wife should never see you out to spirit.
Right.
She should be able to testify in church. I've been married now for 6 months. I've been married now for 3 years. I've never seen my husband out to spirit. I ain't never seen him going, I can't see y'all children. But y'all be, ooh. Oh, you ain't got to do all that. You ain't know.
All right.
No.
No,
there's a spiritual experience that one will have. Now let's read the next verse. Come on, get a little bit of space to go, a little bit of time. Come on.
And the Lord God said,
come on.
It is not good that the man should be alone.
Mama, come on.
I will make him a helpmeet.
Come on.
For him. And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field.
Now, God, after he established the maturity, the wherewithal to handle the responsibility, spiritual foundation, he said, here she is. There's an order. When people come saying that God, and a lot of times God got a divine revelation for them, but they can't get it in order. They can't get it in order. So you know what they start to do? They get upset and they try to do it on their own and try to force the ministry to accept it, or force the saints to accept it. And I'm going to tell you, you'll never regret it. Do it God's way, saying, Lord, I want to do it your way. I want to make sure that I'm in position, maturity. I want to make sure I've established my experience. I want to make sure I got the wherewithal to handle it. And then I want to seek counsel, seek guidance to make sure, even after you get a divine revelation. Matter of fact, go over to 1 Samuel. Let's just look at this verse real quick. 1 Samuel 3. Tell me verse number 1. Even after a person gets a divine revelation, it's important that you seek a spiritual confirmation. 1 Samuel 3, verse number 1. Come on, read.
And the child Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli.
Come on.
And the word of the Lord was precious in those days.
Thank you. It's precious today, too. It's a precious thing to go somewhere and hear the word of God. Come on and read.
There was no open vision.
There was no open vision.
And it came to pass at that time, when Eli was laid down in his place, and his eyes began to wax dim, that he could not see.
Come on.
And ere the lamp of God went out in the temple of the Lord,
my Lord,
where the ark of God was, and Samuel was laid down to sleep, that the Lord called Samuel, and he answered, Here am I. And he ran unto Eli and said, Here am I.
Okay, so here you had God called the child Samuel, but he ran to Eli thinking he called him. Skip down to verse number 8.
And the Lord called Samuel again the third time.
The Lord revealed it to Samuel the third time. Read.
And he arose and went to Eli.
Come on, read.
And said, Here am I, for thou didst call me. And Eli perceived that the Lord had called the child.
So, come on.
Therefore, Eli said unto Samuel, Go, lie down.
Stop right there. So, Eli perceived that God had called Samuel. Eli was ministering over Samuel, kind of like his minister. God revealed to Samuel, called him. Samuel was able to get it confirmed through his spiritual oversight. It's important that when you're making serious moves, that you seek counsel and confirmation. I remember, and I really appreciate Sister Hampton here, we were in a counseling session, and it was some serious concerns regarding the legitimacy of the revelation that these two individuals had received. And we were trying to work with it, and Sister Hampton said something along the lines of, if you were counseled against it, would you be willing to receive the counsel? And let me just tell you this, if you're under a Holy Ghost filled ministry, it's three levels that they'll do. One is, they'll absolutely confirm, God has shown it to me as well. That's, thank you. Yeah. Two is, what's normally the case, is they will not block you and provide you principled counsel regarding the revelation you receive. Give you principled guidance, so on and so forth. No problem, I see nothing amiss, so on. If a Holy Ghost filled ministry ever say, I will hold steady at this time. Or you can sense. I've seen an individual say, God revealed to me, he want me to relocate to such and such a place. This, that, the other. If you only knew the spiritual condition of where they were talking about, that they just went to a meeting in which it was a whole bunch of saints at, and they thought that that meeting was that. And had no idea of some of the background. Came in. Ministry. Pastor said, God ain't show you that. I'm like, woo, let me watch it. Let me just, some see some counsels, you just let it be pastoral, even though you're in the room. Just watch. God ain't showed you that. Wax bold. Well, God did show me. Very well. Person lost out and almost lost their mind.
My God.
No, literally.
God.
lost out and almost lost their mind, if not lost their mind. Why? And I was like, how did you know so clearly that you spoke so firmly to them? He says, God wouldn't lead you somewhere that you didn't have the spiritual wherewithal to meet the need of where you're going and what you're claiming to be led to do. I know the need there, and I know what their capabilities are. It's as far as night and day. It'll be wrong for God to lead them to this right here. I know God is a God of order. So here, if God does, if there is a big decision and God does reveal, it's always wise to give counsel. To say, what about this? How do you feel? And trust me, saints, the Holy Ghost-filled ministry will never get in your way.
Amen.
Never. Because sometimes the devil can work there, but I'm going to tell you, it's the flesh. It's somebody that's doing something they want to do. And they're fearful that what they want to do is not going to be supported because it's what they want to do. You're right. It ain't going to be supported if it's what you want to do and there's been no proper process and you're not in position. Why? Because that's for your own benefit. That's like my child come asking me to, Dad, okay, my cousin so-and-so, this, that, and the other, they got their own apartment. Can I go over there and spend that? I'm not going to sit there. Do you know what they doing over there?
Right.
Are you serious? Don't hardly want you around them. Are you for real? I'm not going to put you in a position to destroy yourself.
Amen.
Not because I don't like you or I'm mean or I'm misleading. I'm looking out for your own soul.
Yes.
So here, let's just touch these as we draw to a close. Number one, God will grant a revelation when a revelation is needed.
Amen.
And I'm just going to give you the scriptures and I'm going to tell you the point so we can get through it. Isaiah 30, 19 through 21, he said, this is the way, walk ye in it. When there's a weighty decision, God will make it clear, this is the way, walk ye in it. You talking about taking a position, you talking about relocating, you talking about marriage, you talking about some things that are weighty. God will grant a revelation when a revelation is needed. This is the way. You don't have to be confused. Number two, Isaiah 30, 19 through 21. It says, this is the way, walk ye in it. You don't have to go by faith and this, that, and the other when it's a serious consequential decision. Number two, the revelation will be clear. Judges 6, 36 through 40. The revelation will be clear. You talking about who? Lord, are you calling me to this? Lord, do you want me to do that? God won't leave it ambiguous. He won't leave it fuzzy. He will make it clear. Judges 6, 36 through 40. Gideon had a serious decision to make. He said, Lord, I'm going to put a fleece outside. And when I wake up in the morning, make everything around the fleece be wet, but the fleece be dry. He went outside, and everything around the fleece was wet. The fleece was dry. Gideon was so serious about being right that he said, Lord, suffer me one more time. Please, let me put the fleece back outside and let everything around the fleece be dry, but the fleece be soaking wet. He woke up the next morning and everything around the fleece was dry, but the fleece was wet. What? God made it clear. I'm not going to leave you just out there. And I'm going to show you, and let me tell you why. Pray for me, saints. When we get a few minutes, we want to pack this in. Once you make certain decisions, you're going to face, sometimes there'll be a honeymoon period. Sometimes there'll be some great time. But you're going to face some situations after you made the decisions that if you didn't get a clear revelation, you're going to doubt was it God. Instead of you just saying that, I'm just going through something, it's going to cause you to almost want to retract the decision, question, was it God or was that in the flesh or should I have done it? Or this, that, and the other? I'm telling you, you talking about marriage? Listen, you get into a tough situation, or y'all two different people, two different backgrounds, two different cultures, two different families, all these two different things. I don't care if you grew up next door to each other, the same congregation, and your mother and father and brothers and sisters. People are different. People are related. People are different. It don't matter. You can, what am I saying? How do I, brother, how can you say it like that? I appreciate Sister Jamisha and Sister Tasha. There are things about them that are different as night and day. I appreciate Quentin and Lee. There's things about us that is different as night and day. My children will have certain experiences and certain things in certain ways that's completely different than the way he is. That's my point. I don't care how close the person is, how close the situation is, when you're raised, it's just different. It's just different. It's different. So here with that, you're going to come to a situation and be like, Lord, was it right? Lord, was it? Was I not? What was I? But when you receive something from heaven and you know you made the right decision, the right choice, even when you face a difficulty, you're not going to have to battle second-guessing yourself. This, no, I'm clear. I made the right reason to work through this.
That's right.
I'm clear. I'm not going back home. I'm not this and the other. I'm okay. I'm not confused. I know what God has shown me. We just need to work through this.
Amen.
So it's imperative to get a clarity in the revelation. Number three, spiritual timing is important. Over in Exodus 13:18, God had already revealed to them they needed a revelation to leave Egypt. God revealed to them clearly that he had a place for them called Canaan. But yet, the timing was important. And in Exodus 13:18, he led them by a pillar, a fire by night, and a cloud by day. They couldn't go behind it, drag their feet, and they couldn't go before it. Oh, Lord. I'm just write these down. Lord, help me tonight. The danger of not acting when God reveals and say, do it, but delaying, in Deuteronomy 1, 25 through 28, read it, as well as 41 through 44. Deuteronomy 1, 25 through 28, the danger of delaying when God shows you. And verse 41 through 44. God has showed them that they were to go up. For whatever reason, they didn't do it. You know what God came back and said? Go ahead. It was all later to set me up. They didn't act upon it. But God said, you can go now. It's too late. You must move when God shows you divine revelation. Why? Because with the divine revelation come divine inspiration.
Amen.
God show you something clearly.
True.
God show you something clearly. You can't toy with it. Just be like, you know what? If tonight God showed you need to get saved, don't wait till you go home. Don't wait till you get with your friend. Don't come back next time. Why? Because there'll be inspiration here for you to deal with whatever you need to deal with to get a breakthrough tonight. If God shows you something in your experience that you need to deal with, my God, deal with it tonight. Don't wait till later. And also, when God shows you a divine revelation concerning a decision or something, you drag your feet, the inspiration that was there, we've seen many people mess up because God showed them and they didn't move when he said move. Also, in regards to spiritual timing, in Numbers 22, 1 through about verse 15, there is a danger in reconsidering a clear revelation. There's a danger in reconsidering a clear revelation. Numbers 22, 1, don't go there, through about 14. Balaam, God has showed him clearly. Balak said, curse the people. God said, don't curse these people. These are God's people. They all came up out of Egypt. They said, curse these people. He said, man, don't curse these people. But they came into a tough situation. Really wasn't even that tough situation. And you know what he said? He said, let me go pray about it again and see what God says. If God show you something clearly, leave it alone. Leave her alone. Leave him alone. Be careful with this. And now you allow some situation or some smooth talker or some for you to go back and reconsider something that God has showed you clearly. God showed you clearly. Don't toy with it. Don't mess with it. But let me tell you, sometimes you can go get counsel from somebody. God showed you that. Be careful with that thing. If God showed you clearly, be careful reconsidering unless there's a spiritual principle that you haven't considered, or something like that, the spiritual overseers letting you know, hold on, be careful with this. You don't know about this right here. You need to reconsider that. That's not right because of that. But I'm talking about something that God that showed you clearly. And you're going to go back and say, you know what? Well, we can start our relationship again. And this, that, and the other. And God has already showed you clearly. Leave him alone. Leave him alone. That's not my will clearly. I'm showing you clearly. And I'm giving you the inspiration. You know why? Because, you know, I don't care how spiritual you are. Whatever relationship you get in, there's going to be emotions. There's going to be feelings involved. And if you're led by emotions and feelings can be resurrected in a moment. Can be resurrected in a moment. It can be somebody that you've done with. You let them cry the right way. See, some guys, they know how to get to people. You let them know how to cry. They just want to bring a little bit of, give their hand in some water while you ain't looking. I'm just saying, I can't make it without you. I'm just saying, you don't even know. I'm just saying.
Is he buying?
Amen. God has showed you revelation. Let him cry out. You know what you will? Give him a God bless you. Go ahead and wipe both sides. Send him those too. But I'm praying for you. I'm not reconsidering nothing. I'm praying for you going about your business.
That's right.
So it's imperative. And it's important not to consider something God has shown you clearly. Also, lastly here, regarding the revelation, 1 Kings 19:12, read that. A lot of decisions to be made. A lot of individuals seeking God for direction. We want God to grant the matters that are essential. A revelation of his will. 1 Kings 19, verse 12.
And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice.
So the last point regarding the revelation, was that point number 5 or 4? 4. Last point is that the revelation is not always loud. The revelation is not always loud. It said after the fire, there's not always going to be an earthquake. Sometimes it's a still small voice. And what that still small voice, pretty much, we're going to a close, is once God gives you that prompting, I'm trying to make this as humanistic as possible, because I don't want us to take the word revelation as some far out thing, but it's simply God revealing to you his will pertaining to a weighty matter. And sometimes in that, God will grant you guidance. And after you make, and after you receive that, there'll come just a calmness and a peace about your decision. It'd just be just a peace, an assurance that you're doing what's right. You're doing what's right. All the trepidation that you've been battling for days and wondering, what if I should have done it? Should I have done it? It'd just come, just a calm, still, small voice that'll let you know clearly you're doing that which is right. This is my will. Many times, people will miss the small voice because A, they're not still enough. They're going here and there. Anyway, sometimes you can't go to everybody talking about what you should do. Sometimes you can't. You need to get along with God. Get along with God. Get away. Get a remove from. I remember I was talking about Pitts. He was telling me, when you get whoever the sister is, come here with me. Before you proceed, we're going on a 3-day. We ain't going nowhere. That's not essential for us to go. We're not eating nothing. We're not going to drink nothing. We're going to stay before God. Maybe just meet up at the church for hours and stay. we're going to get along. But we're going to allow God to make it clear. Sometimes when you got certain Jesus, even before he selected the disciples, he went away for 40 days. He's got to wait. Sometimes before you make certain decisions, you just shut it down. Just shut it down. Get away. Your mom in your ear, your dad in your ear, your sister in your ear, your so-and-so in your ear, so-and-so. Just get away. Get along with God. Say, Lord, once and for all, you reveal this thing to me. And if you are honest, in Hebrews 6, verse about 4 or 5, he said, don't go there. Let me just quote this. Hebrews 11, 6. He said, the Lord is the rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You diligently seek God. You're putting forth that effort. Say, Lord, I'm seeking you. Make this clear. Still small voice. Some people don't get it because they're so busy in the situation, involved in it, connecting with this, that they don't receive that still, and they can't hear that still small voice. There's too much noise going on. And lastly, the reason why they don't hear the still small voice is because they're too emotionally involved and they don't want to do what they hear the voice saying. They're too emotionally involved and they don't really want to do. Let me give you an example. We would be in the backyard. My dad put us up a basketball hoop in our backyard. We had no cement. It was all dirt. We called it the dust bowl in the summer. It was so dusty back there, right? So here we in the backyard shooting hoops, and it may be time to get homework, dinner, time to get ready for church, whatever it is, right? So my mom, we had a big house. She's somewhere in the house, and she said, boys, come in. Well, I hear something, but now we start playing harder. And this and the other, why? Because I don't want to hear that. So now I'm just, man, give it up. Hold on, man, hold on. So when we about to get a whoop, that's, I hear you. I hear you. Well, honestly, I didn't want to hear. I didn't want to hear. So sometimes when we don't really want to hear, we can kind of stay busy, get involved in more stuff, this, that, the other, go hear a whole bunch of, go. I mean, when you know you don't want to hear, what, you need a lot of noise. So when God, sometimes you don't need a lick or a bit of counsel.
Come on.
Because there's principles involved. You see the principles. He ain't in order. He ain't spiritually. He ain't this. She ain't this. Any other. So the spirits will be, the process will be violated if God gave you a spiritual revelation pertaining this when these other things ain't even in order. So now you know that's the case, and God is trying to make it clear to you. So now you want, what you think? Noise. What you think? Noise. So what do you think? Noise. What do you think? Noise. What do you think? I need noise. Shut it down. Get before God. Get a divine revelation and tell him to go on about his business. Shall we?
Amen.